Hej. Good morning, boys and girls. Good morning. How are you this morning? All right. I have a story. The name of today's story is The Boy Who Saved the Pilgrims. And that happened long, long, long ago in 1608. None of us were around back then. Oh, no. The name of the boy was Squanto. And he was an Indian. He lived in Massachusetts, close to that area. And he was going out, walking one day to the beach. And out there, way, way out there, he saw something. What is that? I've never seen that before. And it was coming closer, closer, and closer. You know what it was? It was a ship. And in that ship came some people, and they came out rough looking, and they got this big gun. Whoa! And everybody got scared when that stuff went out. Really, really, literally. Everybody got so scared, and now, whoa, wait a minute, what's going on here? You know what they did? They took Squanto as a prisoner, they put him in the boat, and out the boat went again. Oh boy. He was a slave. They bring him back to England for 9 long years. And there he was learning English and working, working, and working. But he wanted to go back to his home, see his family, his mommy, his sister, his daddy. So he got the opportunity, he got on a ship, and he came back to Massachusetts. This time around, he was very careful who he hung out with. There's dangerous people out there. And this time, he saw another ship coming. Now, what would he do with this other ship? No, no, not again. He hid in the woods. He knew those rough-looking people would come out with guns, and they were ready to shoot another gun in the air. Get ready. So, they got him, they round him up, and in the ship again, back to England. This was the second time. And after spending a few years there, he managed his way to come back to Massachusetts. And guess what? They caught him again. Oh no! And this time he ended up in Malaga, Spain. Oh! That was a different language altogether. Altogether, y cuando la gente le hablaban a él en español no entendía nada de lo que le decía. La miraba así, ¿huh? Problem, big problem. Mm-hmm. So he managed his way back to Massachusetts for a fourth time. Can you imagine? The fourth time, he already knew English, he already knew Spanish, he already knew his language. Oh, he was a very useful person. He saw a ship coming to shore. And when he saw that, he was going to take that gun out and shoot But that didn't happen. Instead, a lady came out of the boat. And another lady with a baby in hands. Now, wait a minute. Might it be that they're trying to stay this time? Yes, they came with babies, with families, children. 101. And he learned something else too. The name of that ship, you know what the name of that ship was? The Mayflower. Wow. These people were different. They didn't come out with guns. They didn't come out trying to round people up and take them as slaves. No, they were kind, loving people. He could see the love in their eyes and their smile. And you know, it was December 26 when that happened. Ooh, December, it's a cold month, especially up in Massachusetts. And you know what was happening? It was snowing. The people didn't have good coats. They didn't have good houses. And very soon they started blowing their noses. And they were, whoa! And you know, by December, 7 of them had died. And in January, 14 of them had died. And in December, 17 of them had died. And they just kept on looking and looking and said, oh boy. Squanto was looking at the people going to the cemetery almost every day, going back to the cemetery carrying someone in. His heart was deeply moved. And he put in his heart, God put in his heart the desire to help these people. So he said, I'm going to help these people. When springtime came, 44 of those people were already dead. Oh, that was so sad. So he came out and he talked to them, and he talked to them in English. Whoa, that was a big surprise. They could speak. They could understand each other. He taught them how to plant. Let me show you this picture because, yes, look what he's doing. He's teaching them. Oh, there they are. What is he putting on the ground?
Fish.
Fish. He's putting...
It helps it to...
Yes? Yes, it does. And he was teaching them how to plant. He was teaching them how to take care of the corn. And he was teaching them so much. And they survived. They had a great crop this year. And so Governor Bradford, the governor of Massachusetts, Lord, if you give me life and health, I want to be useful to help other people. So, I'm going to ask for one volunteer to have a word of prayer. Want to come up? Okay, let's all pray.
Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for taking care of us. Help us do this right. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We may go back to our seats.
Good morning again. Good morning. Happy Sabbath. Feliz Sabado. I know there's some Spanish-speaking brothers and sisters here, so y'all know I just said Happy Sabbath. For the rest of y'all that don't know. I want to take a real quick moment to acknowledge one of my cousins just came down to be with us from Woodbridge. Cookie and her daughter and her grandchildren. Amen. as the deacons come, I just want you to think about something, because when we talk about tithes and offering, we talk about money, right? That's what we think about. First thing, tithes and offering, money. But is that really all that we have to offer to God? God calls us to give our time and our talent. So I'm reading from Romans 12, verses 6 through 8. We have different gifts according to us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If serving, let him serve. If teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it is leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do so cheerfully. And I would add to that, the Lord loveth a cheerful giver. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Amen. The deacons come. Let us pray. God, you are awesome. And Lord, we thank you because every day is Thanksgiving. We don't have to wait till the last Thursday in November. For Lord God, you gave us strength. You gave us health. You gave us life. And Lord, for the Hagerman Thompson family, you gave us a miracle. We gave that miracle back to you today. Father God, bless the giver. Bless the gift. Bless those that have the desire but not the means. Lord, you have blessed us all with something to give. So let us do so cheerfully according to your word. And we will be ever so careful to give you the praise and the glory and the honor, Lord, because you're worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Every hour. my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
At this time, we call this time the Garden of Prayer, in which we have so many things to give God thanks for. If you are impressed to come forward to give God thanks, then do it at this time. If you are impressed to seek something from God, come forward at this time. We are a praying church, and therefore, at this time, we'll seek the Lord for guidance in all things that we do this day.
Amen.
Cast all my cares upon you. I lay all my burdens down at your feet. And anytime I don't know just what to do, I will cast all my cares upon you.
My Lord and my God, my Savior and my King, to you be all the honor and the glory, majesty and power, because of who you are. You are my Creator, my Sustainer, and my Redeemer. I'm not worthy, Lord, to present all your people at this time, but I pray that you, through your grace, will cleanse me from anything that is unlike you, so it will not bar my prayer from reaching you. We thank you, Lord, for all the good things that you have done, because only good things come from you. There is nothing good that comes from the evil one. Everything from the evil one is sadness and destruction. On your resurrection, Lord, he was sealed, and therefore he has nothing good to offer your children. So as we come today, Lord, we come realizing that we have an advocate who is constantly pleading our case. And as we come, we are pouring out to you all the good things that you have done to us and for us. And there are requests that are being requested from you, from your children, that need to be addressed by you. And only you can address some of these issues. Some of them is sadness, loneliness, need a job, need more money, need greater faith in you. And there is so much, Lord, but you know them all. So as we come this day, Lord, we pray that all the things that we do today will be done to your name, your honor, and your glory. Lord, there are some people among us who are sick and is in need of your touch. And you say, cast all our cares on you, because you care for us. So as we come casting our cares on you, Lord, we seek an answer from you. We know what your answers could be, but we are sure that you will not give us more than we can bear, because you have said so. So, Lord, we pray for the people of this church who are not able to be here at this time because of one thing or another, that you would comfort them. You give them a sense that you are ever present in their life and that you makes the difference. We pray at this time, Lord, for the search for a pastor. We pray, Lord, that because of you, you know us better than we even know ourselves. We'll send us someone who have the right gifts that this church needs, and that all that is needed will be done on your time and with your prospective person in mind. Lord, we pray for the sermon today, that the person, Sister Armstrong, giving this sermon is only giving it, but it all came from you. And that we will be edified, we'll be encouraged, we'll be feeling a sense of satisfaction to be in your house today. And it's at this time, Lord, we want to pray for the little Thompson, that you, through your divine glory, will give the people around him all the gift that is needed to make him be a Samuel. So, Lord, we leave him into your hands for your directions. So, Lord, as we embark on this day, may you continue to tabernacle with us. This we ask to your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
I will cast all my cares upon you.
Hello, church. The scripture reading from today is taken from 1 Samuel chapter 14, verse 6. Then Jonathan said to the young man who bore his armor, "Come, let us go after to the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for nothing restrains the Lord from saving by many or by few." Amen.
The door, adore you. Yes, I adore Jesus, I adore you. And the name alive before you, oh Lord. There's a union of two becoming one. Deep inside my heart, I know where I belong. You have given everything to me. At least thing I can do is give it back to you. And all I ever, never will be is for you, Lord. With everything within me, Christ, adore. I adore you. Yes, I adore Jesus, I adore you. And the name alive before you, oh Lord.
Why it surprises me, because God is just always working things out, and yet when he does, why do I seem surprised? I will tell you, I'm looking for a clicker. Thank you. I struggled with what I was, like, Lord, what is it you want me to talk about? And it just nothing was taking hold. And last week, I was looking through some notes. I had the privilege of going to a spiritual retreat that Potomac Conference holds twice a year, and they have spots for pastors and teachers. And Elder Miller always picks a scripture that we just delve into for those 3 days. And I was going back over my notes from that, and it was the story of Jonathan and his armor bearer. And God was like, that's the story I want you to tell. I didn't know why. But I'm here today. We have a baby dedication. We have our youth leading out in so many things. And I'm like, that's why you wanted that story. So he waits till the last minute to tell us, but he just has this plan of putting it all together. And the opening song, He Leadeth Me. I'm like, wow, everything, Lord. You always do that. So I just want to say thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be here and to be your servant today. And I'd like to open with prayer.
Dear Heavenly Father, you have allowed so many of us to be a part of your service today. And you have given me the opportunity to be up here speaking for you. And more than anything, I pray it is your words, because you know what you need each of us to hear. And I pray that I will simply be the vessel with which your words are heard. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Okay, that wasn't what I wanted. There we go. You are very familiar with the stories of King Saul and King David and Jonathan and David and their relationship. And there are a million sermons that can be taken from each one of their lives. So to narrow it down to this was difficult without trying to pull in so many other things. But I'm going to try and stick with the differences between Saul and his son Jonathan. And there is a reason, there is a question mark there. It's not like father, like son, but it's like father, like son. And we're going to explore what those differences are. I'd like to back up, Maya read for us from 1 Samuel 14, but I want to back up to 1 Samuel 13. And if you want to read along with me, I know some of you brought Bibles, there are Bibles in your pews, but 1 Samuel 13, verse 1. And most of the text that I'll be reading from today or have on the board will be from the New Living Translation. It says that Saul was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 42 years. And in his second year, Saul selected 3,000 special troops from the army of Israel and sent the rest of the men home. He didn't keep his army intact. He didn't pursue the Philistines. He sent them home. But that's a whole other sermon. He took 2,000 for himself and went to Michmash in the hill country of Bethel. The other 1,000 went with Saul's son Jonathan to Gibeah. And for those of you that are Bible scholars, if I'm saying it wrong, I'm sorry. This is just the way I've heard it all my life. So Jonathan took his troops to Gibeah in the land of Benjamin. Verse 3, soon after this, Jonathan attacked and defeated the garrison of Philistines at Geba. Did you get that? Soon after this, Jonathan is given an army and boom, he springs into action. The news spread quickly among the Philistines. So Saul blew the ram's horn throughout the land, saying, "Hebrews, hear this, rise up and revolt." All Israel heard the news that Saul had destroyed the Philistine garrison at Geba and that the Philistines now hated the Israelites more than ever. So the entire Israelite army was summoned to join Saul at Gilgal. And just to give you an idea of Michmash and Gibeah, the Philistines mustered a mighty army of 3,000 chariots, 6,000 charioteers, and as many warriors as the grains of sand on the seashore. And some translations say the Philistines had about 30,000 men. Do you remember how many Saul had? 2,000. Jonathan had 1,000, and they're fighting about 30,000. They camped at Michmash on the east of Beth-Aven. The men of Israel saw what a tight spot they were in, and because they were hard-pressed by the enemy, they tried to hide in caves, thickets, rocks, holes, and cisterns. Some of them crossed the Jordan River and escaped to the land of Gad and Gilead. You understand, when they crossed the Jordan River, they were going over to join the Philistines. If you can't beat them, join them. At least, you know, they're not going to pick on you. You'll have safety, shelter. Notice, did you hear that it said they were scared? They saw they were hard-pressed, so they went running away. You don't run away when you have confidence. You run away when you're scared, right? Wasn't it Saul's job to give them confidence? Shouldn't it have been his job to say, "Hey, wait a minute. It doesn't matter that they have 30,000. We are the Lord's chosen people. We are his army. He will lead us into battle." Isn't that what he should have been doing? But he wasn't. So his troops were going away and they were hiding, even, as I said, going over and joining the enemy. Back to 1 Samuel 14, verse 1. One day, Jonathan said to his armor bearer, "Come on, let's go over to where the Philistines have their outpost." But Jonathan did not tell his father what he was doing. And there were two things that jumped out at me. What is Jonathan doing again? He's action. He's getting up and he's doing something. He's not just sitting around. He's doing something. The other thing that jumped out was Jonathan didn't tell his father. And I'm thinking, why? And I'm not a Bible scholar. I don't know, but I'm thinking, it's a lot easier to beg forgiveness than it is to ask permission. And Becky's over there smiling because she knows that's one of my favorite expressions. You know, was he afraid Dad was going to say no? Honestly, I think it was more than that. I think Jonathan knew that the Spirit of the Lord was not with his father anymore. His father was turning his back on God, and God wasn't with him. God couldn't bless him, but the Spirit of the Lord was with Jonathan, and I think that's why Jonathan went. He didn't ask Dad, because Dad wasn't communicating with God, but Jonathan was, and so Jonathan went and did what God was asking him to do. I couldn't get the picture I was looking for, but this was close enough. Do you know what kind of tree this is? It's a pomegranate tree. And let's see where Dad is. Meanwhile, Saul and his 600 men, notice 600, what did he start out with? 2,000, but they all went and ran away. He and his 600 men were camped on the outskirts of Gibeah around the pomegranate tree at Migron. Among Saul's men was Ahijah the priest, who was wearing the ephod, the priestly vest. The New King James Version says Saul was sitting under the pomegranate tree. Jonathan says, come on, let's go check out this outpost. Let's see what we can do. Saul is sitting under the pomegranate tree. Now, it's a desert. It's hot. Yeah. And being the leader, you have to gather your soldiers around and plan and strategize. I get that. But at what point is it too long under the pomegranate tree? At what point are you doing so much strategizing that you're not doing something? We can plan all we want, but if we're not putting that plan into action, that plan isn't doing us any good. Remember back in chapter 13, it said that they were in a tight spot? Well, I want to take you back to chapter 13 and give you one of the reasons why. There were no blacksmiths in the land of Israel in those days. The Philistines wouldn't allow them. How do you like that? The Philistines, the enemy says, nope, no blacksmiths, for fear they would make swords and spears for the Hebrews. So whenever the Israelites needed to sharpen their plowshares, pickaxes, or sickles, they had to take them to a Philistine blacksmith. So on the day of battle, none of the people of Israel had a sword or spear, except for Saul and Jonathan. The pass at Michmash had meanwhile been secured by a contingent of the Philistine army. I know we have a lot of military in our congregation, active and retired. How would you like to go into battle? If you're lucky, a bow and arrow, and that's it. So you now are 600 men, and you are surrounded by 30,000, and you don't have a weapon. Well, the king does and the prince does, but the prince is nowhere to be found right now. It also, there's nothing in here that tells us that they were fighting that. They seem to be okay with it. I mean, if the king wasn't doing anything about it, why should you? And, well, you know, it's easier to go and let somebody else sharpen it for you than to do it yourself. So they'd even kind of followed Saul's example in getting a little bit lazy. So here we are. We are getting ready for battle, and the army does not have weapons. But back to Jonathan. To reach the Philistine outpost, Jonathan had to go down between two rocky cliffs that were called Bozez and Sena. The cliff on the north was in front of Michmash, and the one on the south was in front of Geba. And, you know, I've seen the picture in the Bible storybook, but to see pictures of what it was really like, those are a bit imposing. And as we were discussing this at Spiritual Retreat, there was a question that came up. Why did they name them? Why are their names mentioned in here? Maybe it's just so that people who are reading it, who are familiar with that area, would know exactly where it was located.
But there was another thought, and that is, as imposing as these are, they didn't seem to scare Jonathan. Because if they had intimidated Jonathan, would he have even suggested, hey, let's go over and check out what's going on? And it makes me ask myself, are there any cliffs that I need to name? Are there any obstacles in my life that I need to give a name to and then say, Lord, you're in charge. You're going to see me through this. It was a thought that as immense a task as it seemed, Jonathan was like, let's do it. He didn't let it stop him. This is another picture here. And while I was looking around, I came across a blog somebody had written. It was tworiversblog.com. It was from May 13, 2013. I could not find who the author was, but I thought this was interesting. He said, if I have my information right, this is the valley between the two cliffs called Bozez and Sena. Jonathan and his guard would have had to come from the hill to the left, Sena. His original plan was probably to get a view of the Philistine outpost from the top of that hill. He saw them to make his presence known. This still would have been no big risk since there was still a cliff down and then back up that no army could easily cross. This is why the Philistines have always been raiding to the north, east, and west. Crossing to the south was no easy matter. So just an idea of what Jonathan and his armor bearer were up against. And here is what Jonathan says. Perhaps the Lord will help us. For nothing can hinder the Lord. He can win a battle, whether he has many warriors or only a few. Amen. And there is a whole sermon in that one passage. Amen. Is Jonathan being presumptuous? No. He says, perhaps the Lord will help us. For nothing can hinder the Lord, whether he has many or a few. And at this point in time, how many is a few? Two, right. Not the 600, not the 1,000 or the 2,000, the 3,000. It's the two of them. But he knows that if this is God's plan, God's going to see it through. There was a phrase that Elder Miller used that weekend, and it's been rattling around in my head, and several of us in our small group just latched onto that. And it was this phrase here, the power of perhaps. Because you know what perhaps tells me? Perhaps tells me there's hope. Amen. And if there's hope, there's action. Amen. When there's despair, you're not willing to do anything. Why even bother? What's going to change? But when there's hope, you're willing to do something. And Jonathan was willing to do something, but if the Lord was with him. And he knew the Lord could do it. That's the other thing. He didn't say, hey, we're going to go over there and take it. He said, perhaps the Lord will help us. That also tells me Jonathan knew the Lord could say no. If it's not the right day, the right spot, the right time, God's not going to give the okay. But perhaps the Lord will help us. Jonathan is willing to try and do something. Meanwhile, his father is back sitting under a pomegranate tree. Verse 7, do what you think is best, the armor bearer replied. I'm with you completely, whatever you decide. One of the blogs that I was reading through, a gentleman had made the suggestion that the armor bearer may not have been a young man Jonathan's age. Now, we know that armor bearers could be very young because a few chapters ahead of the, or forward from here, Saul is feeling very distressed. He, the Spirit of the Lord has left him, and he's distressed, and he asks for someone to play, do something to calm him, and somebody suggests the youngest son of Jesse. And so David is brought to the palace, and he plays the harp, and Saul starts to feel much better. But it tells us also, I think it's chapter 17, that when Saul sees him, Saul immediately has a bond with him and loves him. And Saul does not want him to go back to his father and makes him his armor bearer. So David, who is young enough to be Saul's son, probably younger than Jonathan,
is Saul's armor bearer. So we know armor bearers can be very young. This gentleman suggested that it might have been an older and wiser, maybe top soldier of Saul's, because if Jonathan was anything like his father, he could have been prone to making rash decisions. And he may not have just needed protection from others, but he may have needed protecting from himself. And I thought, well, that was an interesting perspective. But when I read this, there are some things that come out at me. First of all, the armor bearer says, do what you think is best. That tells me that the armor bearer and Jonathan had a relationship, a bond, a respect, that the armor bearer knew Jonathan was asking his opinion. Jonathan wasn't just saying, hey, let's go and let's do this. He was asking the opinion. And the armor bearer had enough trust and faith in Jonathan that Jonathan isn't acting rashly, that Jonathan is seeking the Lord, that he says, do what you think is best. I'm with you completely, whatever you decide. And each of us needs somebody like that. We need to know that we've got somebody that has our back, somebody that will protect us from ourselves if we need it, but somebody that's going to be standing there by our side when we need it and encouraging us to. So Jonathan says, all right then, we will cross over and let them see us. If they say to us, stay where you are or we'll kill you, then we will stop and not go up to them. But if they say, come on up and fight, then we will go up. That will be the Lord's sign that he will help us defeat them. Presumptuous. He's saying, the Lord's going to tell us if this is the right day, the right time, the right place. And if not, then we're not doing it. Just another view of what he had to climb. Jonathan knew that this wasn't going to be his battle. He knew that the battle belonged to the Lord. Amen. He knew that he was part of God's army, and he was about God's business, not his own. And if we recall from chapter 13, he'd already been involved in a situation where God led him with a small army to defeat a garrison. So just another look at the map of where they were going. When the Philistines saw them coming, they shouted, look, the Hebrews are coming out of their holes. And then the men from the outpost shouted to Jonathan, come on up here and we'll teach you a lesson. Come on, climb up behind me, Jonathan said to the armor bearer, for the Lord will help us defeat them. We asked God for a sign. He gave us a sign. The battle isn't ours. The battle is the Lord's. He is going to do it for us. There is faith. And where is Saul? Under the pomegranate tree. In action versus action. Like father, like son? No. No. So they climbed up using both hands and feet, and the Philistines fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer killed those who came behind them. They killed some 20 men in all, and their bodies were scattered over about half an acre. Now, if you watch any of the movies out there, you'll go, one guy could have taken on 50. What's the big deal, two guys and 20? Well, it's not the movies. And remember, the armor bearer may well not have had a sword or a spear. The Bible said Jonathan and Saul had them. The armor bearer, I would think, at least had a bow and arrow, but you've got to reload and you have 20 men that you're fighting. They didn't do this alone. They had God's angels with them. God was fighting with them. He kept them safe and he protected them. And then it says in verse 15, suddenly panic broke out in the Philistine army, both in the camp and in the field, including even the outposts and raiding parties. And just then an earthquake struck and everyone was terrified. And I like the New King James Version. And there was trembling in the camp, in the field, and among all the people. The garrison and the raiders, and the earth quaked so that it was a very great trembling. I believe that God's angels were there sounding like an imposing army. And the Philistines are going, we hear them, but we don't see them. Where are they? And they are panicked. They don't know what to do. They're running. They're screaming. And we find out in the next chapter, Saul and his soldiers are going, what in the world? They look out and they see the vast army, the Philistines, begin to melt away in every direction. call the roll and find out who's missing, Saul ordered, because somebody from our camp must have done something. Philistines wouldn't just be doing this for nothing. And when they checked, they found that Jonathan and his armor bearer were gone. My kid's at it again. You know that's got to be going through his head. He did it again. Then Saul and all his men rushed out to the battle and found the Philistines, what? Killing each other. There was terrible confusion everywhere. Even the Hebrews who had previously gone over to the Philistine army revolted and joined in with Saul, Jonathan, and the rest of the Israelites. And likewise, the men of Israel who were hiding in the hill country, okay, now they have hope, now they can take action. They came out and joined the chase when they saw the Philistines running away. So the Lord saved Israel that day, and the battle continued to rage even beyond Beth-Aven. God was in the midst of that confusion. The Philistines may have been confused, but Jonathan wasn't. And those who were on God's side were not confused. They went after the Philistines, which is what they should have been doing all along. What they should have been doing all along. The battle had been won, but by whom? Who led them? Was it the king? No. The King of Kings, yes. But was it King Saul? No. It was his son, the one who should have been led by the king, by his father. But his father wasn't doing what God had called him to do. And family, when we won't do, when I won't do, when you won't do what it's our responsibility to do, God's going to find someone else who will. Like father, like son? No. Thank goodness, no. This story actually reminds me of another story in chapter 17. Again, the Israelite army is being challenged by the Philistines. And again, King Saul is quaking in his boots. And his army is quaking in their boots. Saul should be out there reminding them yet again, we are God's army. Nothing is too hard for the Lord. I think you know the story I'm talking about. So David, this young boy, comes along and says, well, if you're not going to do it, I will. How can you let this giant intimidate you? How can you let him talk about God that way? We are God's people. How can you do that? And this young boy says, I'll fight him. So, of course, Saul, well, you need armor. You need to protect yourself. Remember, Saul stood head and shoulders above everybody else. And here's David. I have to think it didn't fit nearly that well. I'm sure he couldn't even see out of the helmet. He could probably barely pick up the sword. And he's like, no, because he knows he doesn't need that. The only armor he needs is God. He has his sling, which he's been trained to use. But he's not putting his faith in that sling. He's putting his faith in God. And a biblical archaeologist asked me one time, why did he pick up 5 stones? I mean, when you think about it, how quick is this going to be? If he misses, is he going to have time to reload and shoot again? No. So why 5 stones? And the archaeologist said, Goliath had 4 brothers. David didn't pick it up because he didn't trust God. He picked up 5 because he had total faith in God. And if given the opportunity, there were 4 more he was going to go after. Now, we know that the stone didn't kill it. We know the stone knocked him out, and I cannot imagine the thud when he hit the ground. This is what killed him. David ran across, grabbed Goliath's sword, and cut off his head. He defeated the enemy that the king was in terror of. Remember what Goliath said? What am I, a dog that you send this kid after me? He's insulted. Well, he's been insulting God all this time, and the king let him do it. Like father, like son? No. God had a very special work for Saul. And Saul started out doing it. The very first act that Saul did as king was right on. And he went after the Philistines and he routed them. But from that point on, he messed up. Because for Saul, the most important thing wasn't what God asked him to do. It was, well, what are the people going to say? Will they like me? I don't want them to talk bad about me. He started putting the accolades of men before the directives of God. And when he did that, he separated himself from God to the point where God couldn't talk to him anymore. And sadly, God told him, the kingdom is no longer yours. Who knows what kind of king Saul would have been had he done what God asked him to do? We will have no idea. And we know God gave him another chance. Later on in chapter 15, it talks about another chance that God gave him. And when that chance came, what did Saul do? When confronted by Samuel, he made excuses and he blamed others. He would not take responsibility for what he had done. Had he done that, had he realized, I messed up, the kingdom would not have left the family. But Saul didn't do what God asked him to do. And not only did Saul lose out, but Jonathan lost out. I imagine Jonathan would have been a great king, but we will never know. He honored his father. He fought alongside his father. And sadly, he died in battle with his father, never knowing what he could have been had his father not messed up. He did what God asked him to do, but he still had to pay the price for what his father did. You know, we had a baby dedication this morning, Roman Xavier. And we were tasked, and his great aunt even told us, we are tasked with helping to raise him. I don't want to be in the position where I don't do what God asked me to do. And God has to ask somebody else to help raise him. We need to be that right example. And they're going to listen to what we say. They're going to hear what we say, whether or not they listen. But they're going to watch what we do. We have to lead by example, not just word, but by action. And we don't want that action to be something that would lead him away. How Jonathan stayed true to God with the example of his father is a total mystery to me. But he did. He knew, he sensed, as that presence was being withdrawn from his father, God was filling Jonathan with that presence. And I am so glad that Jonathan was willing to be that vessel that God could use. When Israel needed a leader and they couldn't depend on Saul, there was Jonathan. And then there was David. And so, when God calls, will you respond with a yes? Or will we be under that pomegranate tree and say, no, I don't think so? Well, let me take a poll and see what my friends say. Let me see what these people over here would think. I don't want to be like that. I want to be like Jonathan, not like Saul. And one final thought. Remember that God doesn't call the equipped, but he equips the called.
I'd like to ask if you'd all join us in singing our closing hymnal, which is from hymnal 92, This Is My Father's World.
This is my Father's world, and to my sings and round me rings the music of the Spirit. This is my Father's world,
This is my Father's world. He shines in all that's fair. In the rustling grass I hear Him pass. He speaks to me everywhere.